Hi, this is Vanshika Chauhan and I am working as a legal intern with Lexis and Company, and today I'll be talking about the sedition law in India. So section 224A of IPC talks about sedition. It was drafted by Thomas Babington Macaulay in the 1980 and was included in IPC after 10 years of the drafting of IPC or enactment of IPC. So the Britishers had major problems with Indians because Indians used to write publications against them, and they started anti-British movements for independence and also protested for the same. So Britishers earlier had no law to control such acts. Therefore, they brought about the law of sedition after 10 years of the enactment of IPC, which said that whoever by words, either spoken or written, or by signs or by virtual representation, or otherwise brings or attempts to bring hatred or contempt, or excites or attempts to excite to execute disaffection towards the government which was established by law in India, shall be punished with an imprisonment for life, or which can be a fine can be added to it, or an imprisonment which may extend to 3 years and a fine added to it, or just fine. So sedition is a non-bailable offence, and the punishment is up to 3 years to a life term imprisonment. So the Britishers left, but the question was that is this law still required in modern India? Now coming to the historical background of sedition law and how the Britishers used this law in their time. There were famous sedition trials during freedom movements. Some of the famous sedition trials of the late 19th and early 20th century involved Indian nationalist leaders. The initial cases that invoked the sedition law included numerous prosecutions against the editors of the nationalist newspapers. First among them was the trial of Jogendra Chandra Bose in 1891. Bose, the editor of the newspaper Bango Basi, wrote an article criticizing the consent bill for posing a threat to the religion for its coercive relationship with Indians. The most well-known cases are three sedition cases or trials of Bal Gangadhar Tilak and the trial of Mahatma Gandhi in 1922. So Gandhi was charged with sedition along with Shankar Lal Bankar, the proprietor of Young India, for three articles published in the Weekly. Now, what was the stance of the Supreme Court on this law? In 1962, in the case of Kedarnath Singh versus State of Bihar, the Supreme Court said that a citizen has a right to speak or write whatever he likes about the government or its measures by way of criticism or comment, so long as he does not incite violence. So, further in 1982, another case of Pallavi versus State of Kerala, the Supreme Court held that sloganeering or criticizing of parliament or the judicial setup did not amount to sedition. Then ultimately in 1995, in the case of Balwant Singh and others versus State of Punjab, the Supreme Court said that passing some slogan saying Khalistan Zindabad a couple of times, which neither evoked any violence nor any response from the public, cannot be charged as sedition and cannot be charged for punishment under sedition law. So, Section 124A is criticized with Article 19 of the Constitution, which provides for the certain freedoms and rights which are not absolute in nature and are subject to certain reasonable restrictions. Now, the government, using these reasonable restrictions, uses the sedition law. Section 124A and Article 19 of the Constitution are not mutually conclusive, meaning they are not mutually acceptable. Also, if you are accusing someone of sedition, then you are violating his or her fundamental right under Article 19 of the Constitution of India. And similarly, in the case of Shreya Singhal, wherein it was a 2015 judgment, the Supreme Court said that when a school-going girl criticized the government, would not amount to sedition if no one was incited by it, or no violence was created by it, and no law and order was disturbed by whatever she said. Talking about sedition law around the world, so sedition law is basically a Victorian era law, which means that it was enacted during the reign of Queen Victoria, and it is also an anachronistic law, which means that it eradicates the modern values which are the freedom of speech and expression and democracy. Now coming to the various countries which have enacted and abolished the sedition law. First is US, wherein some sedition laws have been repealed and some have been declared as dead laws, but courts still provide protection to freedom of speech. coming to UK, we have adopted the sedition law from UK since Lord Macaulay drafted it. And the last sedition trial in UK was in 1947, and laws were abolished in 2009 for not reflecting values of a vibrant or a modern democracy. Coming to Nigeria, sedition law exists, but prosecution for seditions have largely fallen into disuse since 1979. Next is Malaysia. It has sedition law in use. Although the constitution guarantees freedom of speech and expression, sedition laws are still used stringently. Next is Australia. Since 1985, scope of the law narrowed and the punishments were brought down from imprisonment to just fines. Last is New Zealand, where the law was abolished in 2007 and similar offences were addressed through the ordinary criminal law provisions. The modern constitutional democracies have either abolished or let the provisions of sedition fall into disuse. Talking about India, only a handful of sedition cases have resulted in a conviction. The cases reported in 2016 were 35, whereas the cases resulted in conviction in that year was just one. Similarly, the cases reported in 2017 were 51, whereas the cases which resulted in conviction was just one. Now, in 2018, 70 cases were reported, wherein only two resulted in conviction. So this law is used for the purpose of harassment mostly. And recently, Supreme Court on 30th April 2021 constituted a 3-judge bench to examine the constitutional validity of the sedition law under Section 124A of IPC. The bench said that India has certain obligations under the international law, as it is bound by the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights for the protection of freedom of expression as a right of all the individuals of India. And since Section 124A puts a restriction on the freedom of expression, it is yet to be considered if it is valid or not.